If you use Ableton Live for stems on stage, what do you do when one of the songs in your set has a tempo change? Hey, this is Will Doggett. Today, I want to show you how to deal with stems and multi-tracks that have tempo changes. It's way easier than you think. So let's get started. This week's tutorial is brought to you by Oyen Digital and the brand new Avastor HDX Pro. Now, what I love about this drive is it works great both as a desktop drive and a portable drive. Now, you can use the included stand to dock the drive vertically if you're working at your desk, or if you're on the go, just grab the drive and throw it in your bag. You can also use the lockbox for extra protection as you're moving between gigs. And you also get a USB-C cable as well as a USB-C to USB-A cable, so you always can connect it to your computer no matter what you're using and no dongles necessary. So for more information about this drive or any Oyen Digital drive, head to oyendigital.com. That's oyendigital.com and use the code WILL10OYEN for 10% off anything in the Oyen Digital store. Thanks so much to Oyen Digital for their support of From Studio to Stage. Now, this is part four of a four-part series on warping. In order to really grasp all this, I'd encourage you to go back and rewatch the first three videos. I've included the links to those below. So let me show you how to do this. So in order to deal with this and to say, for instance, have the tempo change stay with the stems but use Ableton's click, you need to make sure you've warped your stem. So we're gonna warp our stems, but we're gonna go a step further to show you how to keep the tempo change in the stem. Okay, so let's drag our stems in. First thing I'm going to do is set my tempo just like we talked about before. And I know my song's tempo starts at 95 BPM. So I'm going to go over to my browser and select all the stems for this song and hold command as I drop them in to put them in their own tracks. We've talked about that in the past couple weeks. And now let's select all our stems and make sure that click track is the last clip that we have selected. So with all those selected, I'm going to hit warp. With our click track selected, I'm going to zoom in here and I need to find where the click gets off the grid. Now, I know this is right around measure 16, but what you want to do is look at your file. Now, don't zoom in too much because one of the things I see people do a lot of times is really zoom in super far and they end up doing more work than they need to. So I'm going to zoom out just enough to see that, okay, starting right here at about beat three is where my click seems to get off the grid. So I'm going to double click here again to create a warp marker to lock everything to the left of measure 16 in time. And I'm going to add my first warp marker right at 16.3 or beat 3. And then I'm just going to go and add warp markers every time that is going to kind of shift those transients, those beats on grid. So I'm going to go through here and it looks like, let's try adding them. I by default try to add them every measure. It looks like I might have to do every two beats, which is perfectly fine. So the process for doing this is you want to go through and double click and just drag these over, start at about a measure. You see it's starting to kind of even out here, and just add a warp marker about every measure, every four beats. Okay. So it looks like that lines up perfectly. So what I'm going to do is just go through the song and add my warp markers in. Okay, so as you do this with your file, again, work left to right and continue to add your warp markers. And what you're likely going to find is once your tempo kind of equalizes and it hits the point that it's going to stay at the new tempo, you can stop doing warp markers. So I had to do a couple measures to kind of get us there. But then now that I'm here at about measure 29, when I look at the rest of the file, again, the click is lined up on the grid. So what I'm going to do is just go to the end here. And again, this is just habit. I talked about this in the warping stems video. I just add a warp marker at the end of the file to kind of pin that in place. So with this small section, a couple measures of warp markers, I now have basically told Live exactly where the beats should go. And what Live is going to do is do some math under the hood to try to figure out what the tempo should be in that section. Now, two more things I need to do so that Live, instead of playing this at a straight tempo, will follow the tempo of this. So first thing I'm going to do is change beats to complex. And we talked about that before, but that makes sure that these files play back at the highest possible quality for a full song or for stems. Now what I'm going to do is go up to my click track here, and I want to change my click track to be the thing that sets the tempo for the rest of this file. I talk a lot about using a tempo track, but when I am using a file that has a tempo change, that's where I want to use the click track that's included with the file to be the master for that file. So if you're on Live 10 or higher, you want to go down here where it says follower and click that to leader. Or if you're on Live 9 or earlier, go from slave to master. And then what you see as soon as I do that, let's actually open our master track up here and look at the song tempo. You see that that tempo automation is now written into the live's master tempo. So let's just scroll over a little bit and let's press play and listen to this. And I'm gonna turn on live's metronome and turn off our click track. You'll hear it's perfectly in sync, tracks with the click, but listen now. Start to speed up. And then we level out at about 110 BPM. But the one thing you didn't notice was the click was not like swaying. The click was perfectly in time with the tracks. And the reason it was because we warped this file and we set the click clip for this file to be the thing that sets the tempo for the live set. It is the leader of this. It's the master of this. And the live set and live's grid, underlying grid, is following that. So from here, I could go in and add a tempo track, markers, locators, all the stuff I typically add to my file, but I know it's going to be synced to the grid, so I can add my automation, my MIDI click, all sorts of things. So this wraps up our four-part series on using warping with Ableton Live. But if you want to learn more about tracks or how to take this even further and format your song for live performance, then head to fromstudiostage.com/playback. You're going to see all the courses I put together where we talk about using Ableton Live on stage in a playback situation. We'll talk about connecting your audio interface, routing audio, formatting your song. So this way you could step on stage with a set that's been programmed very efficiently and it's stable and you have lots of flexibility. So again, head to fromstudiostage.com/playback to check that out. Thanks so much for watching this. We'll see you guys next week. Take care. Bye-bye.